This last ayah, the summary of Ash-Shawkani rahimahullah is أَيْجَمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْإِيمَانِ بِاللَّهِ وَالْعَمَلِ الصَّالِحِ فَإِنَّهُمْ فِي رَبْحٍ لَا فِي خُسْرٍ. That these people gathered and they combined between iman and good action. And this is something that comes up in tafsir over and over and over and over again. Iman and action are necessary consequences of each other. If you do good deeds, your iman will increase. And if you have iman, there's no way you can have it without doing good deeds. What kind of iman is this that you have it and it doesn't lead you to any action? That's impossible. And there's no good action that doesn't end up increasing your iman. Okay, so they have this mutual relationship. So when they develop this, فَإِنَّهُمْ فِي رِبْحٍ, then they are definitely in profit and not in any kind of loss. When they are able to make that connection between iman and action. Unfortunately, a lot of Muslims believe their iman, rather their Islam, is good enough. They're set for paradise because they already said La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Without getting into any theological historical debates about which group said this about iman and amal, which group said that, without getting into any of that, just from a psychological point of view, people have that as an escape, just like Christians have the escape. I already said the name of the Lord, you know. I already pronounced. I said I love Jesus. Now I could be a drug dealer for all I care. It's all good. I'm already saved. We have the same exact mentality seeped into the Muslim community when somebody says, I'm already Muslim. Yeah, I messed up. I do a lot of haram things. But come on. I already got my ticket right here. I already said La ilaha illallah. I already said Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's good enough. I should be alright because my iman is there. This surah makes it clear. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, not enough. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. When you fulfill all four, then you're saved. Until then, you're not saved. And what it also teaches is, if you think you have iman and none of this is happening, then you probably don't have iman. Chances are, you think you have iman, but you don't. So the Bedouins thought they had iman. قَالَتِ الْعَرَابُ آمَنَّا. In Surah Al-Hujurat, they said, we have iman. Allah said, قُلْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا. No, you didn't get iman yet. وَلَكِنْ قُلُوا أَسْلَمْنَا. You only have Islam. وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. Iman hasn't entered your hearts yet. And what is the proof that iman hasn't entered your hearts yet? وَإِن تُطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. If you obey Allah and His Messenger, doesn't action get mentioned? Allah says you don't have iman, you only have Islam. But iman hasn't come into your heart. What should you do to get it into your heart? Obey Allah and His Messenger. Do action. لَا يَلِدْكُم مِّنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ شَيْءٍ. None of your deeds will be wasted away. SubhanAllah. These are the combination of these two things. A couple of notes left, inshallah, in the next 5 minutes we'll be done. I'll just read through them quickly. As Zamakhshari comments when it comes to tawasaw bil haqq, in the explaining al haqq, he says tawheed includes tawheed, includes obedience to Allah and His Messenger, it includes being distanced from worldly ambition and inclination towards the hereafter. Ash-Shawkani, when he talks about tawasi bil haqq, he says wassa ba'duhum ba'dan bil haqq alladhi yahiqqu al-qiyam bihi. They enjoin to each other, exhort each other, advise each other with the truth that deserves to be established, meaning they give each other advice that should be implemented. Qatada says bil haqq ay bil Quran. Beautiful. Qatada rahimahullah says when they give each other the best counsel to the truth, the word truth, he says the truth here means the Quran. They give each other ayat of Quran full of love and affection and concern for the other. So we remind each other through the ayat of Allah. May Allah include this gathering in that. So we, and then ay bil Quran wa qila bit tawheed, and it's also said they remind each other with tawheed wal haml ala al umum al ula, and most people understand it to the first meaning any good, any truth that deserves to be established and to be lived by. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِقُلُوبِهِمْ. Those who truly believed with their hearts. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ بِجَوَارِحِهِمْ. And they did good deeds with all of their limbs. Meaning, once their heart was submitted, their entire body submitted by good deeds. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَهُوَ أَدَاءُ الطَّاعَاتِ. And they enjoined and exhorted each other to the truth, and this is giving of executing all the acts of obedience. وَتَرْكُ الْمُحَرَّمَاتِ, and to abandon all the things that are haram. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ أي عَلَى الْمَصَائِبِ وَالْأَقْدَارِ. And they enjoined, exhorted each other to perseverance, meaning against all kinds of calamities and all kinds of situations that they find themselves in. And telling each other about the truth is a good thing. So why mention good things and then mention one of them? This is al-khas ba'd al-am. This is a special good deed after the general, the one of which is the of most importance or the one easiest forgotten. This came up before. That's what he's mentioning. لِأَنَّهُ دَاخِلْ فِي عَمِلِ الصَّالِحَاتِ, because it is included in the good deeds. عَلَى مَا يَبْلُ اللَّهِ بِهِ عِبَادَهُ عَنِ الْمَعَاصِي. The Makhshari comments in Tawasi bil-Sabr, this is sabr over whatever Allah tests his slave with, and also sabr and not falling into temptation. In disobedience. In other words, the believer will be put into times of temptation. He'll be seduced into getting into things. His greed might take over him. His temptation might take over him. And at that point, he has to have sabr to not fall into those things. May Allah protect us from falling into disobedience. And then finally, on the sequence, وَجَعَلَ التَّوَاسِ بِالصَّبْرِ قَرِينًا لِلتَّوَاسِ بِالْحَقِّ دَلِيلٌ عَلَى عَظِيمِ قَدْرِهِ. Allah puts sabr at the end and haqq first, is as an evidence of the power of enjoining the truth, that it's more powerful and more important. وَفَخَامَةِ شَرْفِهِ rather, and the weight of its nobility. وَمَزِيدُ ثَوَابَ الصَّابِرِينَ عَلَى مَا يَحِقُّ الصَّبْرَ عَلَيْهِ. This is, you know, تَوَاسِي بِالْحَقِّ, what he is saying in this ayah now, الشَّنْقِيطِ رَحْمَهُ اللَّهِ is saying, الصابرين are those who, whenever the situation comes that demands patience, they execute it. There's one thing to encourage each other to be patient. It's another thing to be patient when it's time to be patient. We lose our patience, and when somebody says, "You know, you need to be patient right now." No. This is not the time to be patient. I know I should be, but you don't understand. This is a special case, right? Every time you need to be patient, you say, "I have a special case exception," right? This is exactly what a person who doesn't have sabr does. You know, whenever the advice is given, they say, "I know that's the advice, but I have an exceptional situation. I know I should have sabr, but not right now. This is good advice. I know it's in the Quran, but not for me, not for right now." But that's the attitude we have to get rid of. All the advice of this book is for me right now. There's never a time when it doesn't apply. And when you start thinking like that selectively, then these things become useless. This advice is useless. Because when you need it the most is when you abandon it. When does the advice to have sabr become important? When you're losing your temper, when you're tempted, when you're going to fall into disobedience. That's when it's important. When you're sitting in a gathering of good people, "I should be patient." Yeah, I should be patient. That's not an accomplishment, you see. If you just reflect on history and how many people have come and failed and have gone, they had a little bit of time to become a success and they didn't make use of that time and they failed and they're gone and their chance is over. Then a new generation came with a new chance and they lost their chance and their time was over. And now it's my turn. I have a chance. I better not make the mistake that these people made, which is why Allah tells me of the nations of the past who lost the opportunity. You know, Allah is alluding to all of those historic accounts in the Quran just in the word wal asr. Because all of them, their ultimate loss was not availing the time that they had before it gets too late. You know, min qabli an ya'tiya, you know, adab al aleem, before a punishment comes, make veil of that, you know, avail that time. And finally, of course, the signs of revelation. When you're too preoccupied with your own life, you fail to look at the Quran, you fail to look at revelation, you fail to look at the legacy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for guidance. Oh, how should I live my life? What should I aspire towards? Because if your only concern is your career, you're really not going to get career advice and programming from the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? You're not going to get that from the Quran. But if you're looking for where should I spend my money, how should I raise my kids? How should I be to my neighbor? What more do I owe my parents? When you start thinking, you know, why am I? What good can I do? Then you turn to the book. Then you turn to the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. So this preoccupation with the self, in and of itself, is a loss of the human being. Then, as far as one of the beautiful things I want to comment on also is a statement from Shah Waliullah Dahlawi, rahimahullah, talking about asr, the word asr in this ayah, and connecting it with the loss of the human being. Shah Waliullah Dahlawi rahimahullah has a term he uses for certain passages of the Quran. He calls them at-tadhkir bi ayyamillah, reminder by the days of Allah. Reminder by the days of Allah. What are the days of Allah? It is the day He created the human being, the day on which He sent revelation to His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the day of Badr, the day on which the flood came to the disbelievers against Nuh alaihi salam, the day when the water was parted, the day when Fir'aun was destroyed, etc. The day when Musa alaihi salam spoke to Allah azza wa jal. These are amazing days in human history. And Allah refers to these awesome days all over the book, doesn't he? Of course, in the future, there are also amazing days coming. The day of judgment, the day on which the believers will get to see their Lord, etc., etc. These are incredible occasions of time. And by using wal asr,